Hello. Thanks for the nice introduction. So, a lot was already said. So 3 years ago, many of us were shocked to learn that we're not the paranoid conspiracy theorists, but that many of the things we suspected was actually true. Our entire digital world is under total surveillance. A famous person, Edward Snowden, said that he, quote, sitting at his desk, could wiretap anyone.
And it's like not just like about the serious things, it's about really anyone and everyone. It's about games and porns. It's about surveilling people, yeah, playing Angry Birds. It's about surveilling people watching porn to have an opportunity to discredit them afterwards.
And yes, everyone even includes chancellors of countries.
And we will show you a short video now.
With the reaction.
Yeah.
We need it full screen.
Double click.
Yep. Maybe some of the English people, speaking people here don't know it yet because it, I think it wasn't translated into English so much, so you can read the subtitles. And you now hear.
Vorwurf der vermeintlichen Totalausspähung in Deutschland ist nach den Angaben der NSA, des britischen Dienstes und unserer Nachrichtendienste vom Tisch. Es gibt in Deutschland keine millionenfache Grundrechtsverletzung.
Wir sind. Ja. And then. Just a few months later, things came out and our Chancellor Merkel said something slightly different.
Verbündete, aber solch ein Bündnis kann nur auf Vertrauen aufgebaut sein. Und deshalb wiederhole ich nochmal, ausspähen unter Freunden, das geht gar nicht. Wir sind Verbündete, aber solch ein Bündnis kann nur auf Vertrauen aufgebaut sein. Und deshalb wiederhole ich nochmal, ausspähen unter Freunden, das geht gar nicht.
Das geht gar nicht, that's a no-go.
Yep. That's a no-go, but we all know like the narrative of Germany and the US being very close partners, and it's not about being close partners only in a diplomatic way, it's also about being a close partner in the spy agency way. And Edward Snowden said fairly at the beginning of the revelations that NSA and our German Foreign Secret Service, BND, would be in bed together. Now to the political reactions. What came like after all those Snowden's revelations were like, yeah, was written about in Germany? As the Herald already mentioned, there was this inquiry committee established, and it's the only inquiry committee that, yeah, evolved after the Snowden revelations. So there's kind of something special about it in Germany.
Yeah, so the German Federal Bundestag, the Federal Parliament, is investigating the spying accusations of the Five Eyes and the involvement of the German spy agencies. So how much mass surveillance is actually being done? And when this inquiry was formed, the BND, and this is a quote from an internal document of theirs that we leaked, the BND had great concern that such an inquiry committee would focus on the activities of the BND's SIGINT division, of looking what the hell the BND is actually doing, and not only the NSA, the GCHQ, and the Five Eyes. So that's what we tried to do as journalists, and that's what the committee was also trying to focus on.
Like, the work of the committee is kind of complicated because, like, the primary source of information for them are documents that the public shouldn't see. And it's like a lot of documents. By now, it's almost 2,400 folders of documents, of paper, which might sum up to millions of pages. And those millions of pages are not easily readable from time to time because there's a lot of black on the pages. So there's also the people trying to kind of, yeah, get to know what the BND does together with the NSA and the other Five Eyes. Yeah, they can't see it because it's too secret for them to see it.
So one aspect of the work that the inquiry is doing is they're asking government ministers and chancelleries and the BND, give us your documents so we can read what you've been doing. And in addition to reading the documents, which we are not a part of, there are the public hearings of witnesses and experts in the Bundestag rooms where we go to watch those hearings. Officially, streams are forbidden, recordings are illegal, you could get kicked out of parliament and never be let in again. But they say, maybe you've seen the theater representation last night at the very beginning, because the public can come into the building, that the hearings are somehow public, even if there is no recording or transcription. So what we do is we go there and we live transcribe ourselves. We go to the hearings and we transcribe everything all the parliamentarians, the government, and witnesses are saying. And that's cumbersome work. So we have printed out the internet of what we've done, and we have about three folders of what we wrote in the last 2.5 years, standing right here, right now. And after the talk, if you're interested in a printout of the internet, just come by and we can give you a copy of your favorite witness hearing.
But it's not just about writing what's happening there. It's like, if you can't go there and if you didn't see the situation, then it's really difficult to get an impression on which people are sitting there. Like, what are the people working at those spy agencies and surveilling the world and helping to surveil the world? And therefore, like Stella did, start to draw those people who testify in front of the committee. And because drawing like the witnesses like 2 or 3 times doesn't make so much sense, she began to form the witnesses out of modeling clay, and you can see those witnesses in the exhibition next to the wardrobe, I think, for the next days.
So who are those witnesses in the inquiry hearing in Bundestag? Well, witness number one is called Edward J. Snowden, because the it doesn't take a lot of brain power to discover that he is an important person that could reveal information that is relevant to the committee's cause of investigating what the hell Secret Services are actually doing. But as you probably heard, there is a huge fight, a political fight. He hasn't been in the inquiry hearing yet, and there are only 4 more hearings in January and February. And unfortunately, as of now, it is pretty much, there's a pretty low chance, if even, that he will actually be heard by the committee.
And that makes like people not believe in the seriousness anymore. And Glenn Greenwald, who like wrote about many of the documents, told the German politicians as they invited him that they care far more about not upsetting the US and not destroying like their partnership than they do about conducting a serious investigation.
So in solidarity with Ed, Glenn also didn't come. So what did we actually learn from all those documents, the press releases, the statements, and the witness hearings? Well, first of all, BND really and the German spy agencies really are in bed together with the Five Eyes, with the other spy agencies from the US, UK, New Zealand, Australia, and Canada. They're doing similar things. They're doing mass surveillance of the digital world. And also the German spy agencies, like the others, are extremely bending or sometimes plainly outright breaking the law.
We have a few of those funny theories they make up, and for example, there's satellite interception. And to satellite interception, there's like, basically a limit set by the law, and the BND didn't like this, so they thought about how could we circumvent this limit, and they invented the space theory. So they said, like, all those satellites, they aren't in Germany, they are in space, and if we intercept the satellites, then it's not in Germany, so we don't have to comply to the law. And they, I think the worst thing on this is that they made up this theory after Snowden, so they did this for a really long time. And then, as they noticed, like it's really getting uncomfortable in here, they thought about like how could we explain this.
So the theory is, in Bavaria, in Bad Aibling, where the station with the red domes is, where they're surveying satellite communication, somehow German law does not apply because they're gathering information from the satellites in space. But it gets even weirder because they're extending that to the so-called virtual foreign countries. This is one of the many buildings that the Frankfurt Internet Exchange Datex's house did. And the BND is saying, yeah, well, we're surveying fiber optic cables on German soil from a German ISP, but it's a virtual foreign country because technically we're trying to get international data transfers from those German fiber optic lines. Again, so German law doesn't apply there.
And it gets even funnier. We can translate it to the functionary theory, and it says that if you are in a function, if you are German and you are in a foreign country and working for maybe the EU, and you write emails, then you don't have any protection of your fundamental rights, like here's privacy, because you are in a function and you are not a German and fundamental rights don't apply to you.
So what other things did we learn from the inquiry committee besides weird legal theories that don't really stand up to a legal test? Well, we learned about a few operations that the German spy agencies were doing in the past. The first operation that has been most widely reported and talked about is so-called Operation Icona, which ran from 2003 to 2008. It was a joint operation of the German BND and the NSA. It was happening in Frankfurt, Germany, and they were tapping an internet exchange of the German telecom. And the weirdest part is, they always say that, we're only surveying foreigners. We're only surveilling terrorists. So you might say, okay, Frankfurt Internet Exchange, that's maybe not so foreign. But then on this Internet Exchange, there's many cables from carriers coming together for doing peering, for making the internet work. And we found out that this BND was tapping cables running from Vienna to Amsterdam and cables running from Luxembourg to Prague. Now, they always keep telling us it's only about the terrorists in Afghanistan or Somalia, but I think that's not really terrorist.
And there are other operations. There's one operation you are not even allowed to say the name of. It's like Klotaik, and it says that the last three letters, like AIC, are, if you reverse them, it's CIA. And so it's a cooperation between the BND and the CIA, and they used like a German provider, MCI WorldCom, which is now known as Verizon, and there they tapped allegedly phone and fax communications.
So another operation that we learned about in the inquiry committee, although we always suspected it, was when Klaus Landefeld came to the inquiry committee and told, after Operation Icona and tapping the internet exchange in Frankfurt from Deutsche Telekom, the BND came again and said, okay, now we want to tap DASIX, the big Frankfurt internet exchange. And when Klaus was in the inquiry committee, he said, well, the BND came and basically they demanded a full take. They wanted everything of all the things that could possibly, of all the traffic that could possibly be routed by DASIX. Now, after some legal back and forth, it was clamped down a little bit because of legal restrictions back then. But still, part of the surveillance the German foreign spy agency did inside of Germany was of six German ISPs. So instead of going to the German internet operator and saying, well, we want to tap your cables, they went to DASIX, to the internet exchange, and said, we want all traffic that comes to you from this German provider.
And there's the other operation, which is called Monkey Shoulder, and there's the suspicion that it's called after whiskey. And it's an operation between the GCHQ, the NSA, and they wanted to go to the Deutsche Telekom and get the transit communication and transfer the raw data to the Foreign Secret Services. And one special thing about this operation is that allegedly the chancellery was not informed. So even those who should watch, like the surveillors, didn't know about it, or at least they say they didn't know about it. And this operation started in 2012, and it was stopped after the Snowden revelations came out because they said, like, okay, it's getting a bit too hot in here.
So, and then it gets murky. The Enquirer Committee was able to investigate the ancient operations Iconal and Glowtyke without being able to say the name Glowtyke. They always had to say Glow. But from the other operations, we somehow found out that there's another operation called Warp Drive, which the BND does together with the NSA and another partner. But we don't know which one, we don't know where it ran, we don't know what provider was targeted, and we don't even know if it already ended. We just know the name, and we would be interested in more information on that.
And there is a lot of other interception operations. And we see like a table here, but one thing about this table is that it's only operations that ended and they are not running, because we don't get to know anything about operations that are still taking place today. It's just about like things in the past, so we don't really know what's going on right now. And it's also that in the inquiry committee, they can only talk about operations with the Five Eyes. That means like the Canadians, the people from New Zealand, Australia, Britain, and the US, but we don't know anything about operations with other countries, and yeah, there might be many, many more.
So, but the blacked-out ones here, we revealed this list of the operations that the German spy agency BND is doing, but the blackouts, even the members of the inquiry committee are not allowed to find out what the hell that actually is that the Secret Services are doing. They are supposed to look into this ancient, and by now I'm bored of Operation Iconal and Glowtyke, and the more interesting stuff of what is going on now, in this very moment, that's not for them to investigate. This is one of the favorite slides of one of the members in the inquiry committee. I don't know if you remember that. It's about an operation called Rampart A. And it looks as if the NSA is using local partners in other countries to do the tapping for them and then gather all the data. So we had the running theory, I think it's almost confirmed now, is that Operation Iconal was such a thing where the BND went to an internet exchange in Germany, did a little filtering out of Germans, surveying the fiber optic cables, and then giving that data pretty much in raw shape to the NSA. Now, whether the BND knows that it's giving the data to the NSA or not, that is an open question the Enquirer Committee has not yet found out. But this slide shows that the NSA definitely has operations where the local partner does not know that the NSA is getting way more than they said publicly.
Another thing is XKeyscore. XKeyscore is a tool, and it has kind of the nickname NSA's Google, because it's like a tool to search through a massive amount of data. And it's used by the German Secret Services. It's used in Bad Aibling by the BND since 2009, and had a predecessor that ran since 2007. And it's also deployed in other outposts, but we have like, murky testimonials about this, and they're running at least in test mode. And this kind of thing, test mode, is also running in our domestic secret service. And there was like the contract published that how they got this thing from the NSA, and they got it for free, so they didn't pay anything for it, at least not money. So there was kind of the deal, we give you all the equipment and you give us the data that you get out of there.
So during the Snowden revelations, when the name XKeyscore came up, everyone was pretty freaked out because it was one of the first and one of the big revelations, and our German government said, oh, those Americans, they're doing really fancy stuff there, but we would never do that. But the inquiry committee found out that for years and years, the BND has been using the exact same tool in the exact same way. Another tool that even goes beyond what the NSA is doing is a tool called Verus. That's a tool that the BND developed together with the German armed forces, the Bundeswehr. And It gathers metadata, communication metadata of who communicates when with whom, like classic data retention stuff. And the special thing about this tool Veris is that it captures all the metadata of all traffic on a communication line like a fiber optic cable. So it's not being selected at all, only a little tiny part of obviously, German communications are thrown away, but we learned that the NSA is apparently is retaining three, four, five hops of metadata communication. Well, look, the BND is gathering all hops. So in one of the first hearings, a BND witness said, oh yeah, we're retaining like six hops of metadata. And we were like, six hops? There is an experiment. It's called the Small World Experiment. It's also known in English speaking world as the so-called 6 degrees of separation, that every human on this planet knows every other human over six hops of people in between. So when the BND is actually collecting, what did they say recently? Oh yeah, the system wouldn't stop you if you were to look into 9, 10, 12 hops.
But it gets slower.
But it gets, the system gets slower, yeah. So this was one of the things that was pretty interesting for us, that the BND is not limiting metadata at all. So now, this being a HackerCon, we wouldn't have gotten our talk accepted if we didn't drop some formerly non-public information. So we have some ODE for here now. Used to be classified secret.
We have like amounts of metadata collected and retention periods of metadata for the different outposts of the BND. So we have Schöningen here, and it's 2 million metadata a day, and with a retention time of 10 years, like 10 years.
Bad Aibling, one of the most famous outposts of the BND in Germany, is collecting 5 million metadata every single day and is retaining that for 3 months. Rheinhausen, another outpost, it's collecting 15 million points of metadata every single day and is retaining that for 6 months. Gablingen, we don't really know a lot about that, but that's an outpost that collects 180 million points of metadata every single day and is retaining them for an entire year. And Pullach, BND's HQ as of now, is collecting an additional 20 million points of metadata every single day and is retaining them for 10 years. And this is unique because, as opposed to the other outposts before, this is collecting the data that is coming from tapping points of fiber optic cables like on the Frankfurt Internet Exchange.
And if you do the math and you sum up all this, you, yeah, come to the number of 220 million metadata per day. And then you might ask yourself, like, what is the BND doing with this metadata? Does the BND keep this metadata? No, it doesn't.
Yes, they do, but not
only.
Yeah,
they keep it, but not only. Then there's a number, and that's the metadata per month pushed directly to the NSA. It's like 1.3 billion metadata monthly.
So it's not, it's sitting on a BND server and the NSA can query it. The BND gathers this data and then pushes it onto a server directly to the NSA hardware. So, metadata is taken by every single communication on a communication line that this German spy agency is tapping. But apparently content of communications, like the contents of emails or phone calls, are only selected. Which just means like you throw out a big phishing net with some of those communication types, identifiers like browser IDs. Most typical ones are IP addresses, email addresses, stuff like that, phone numbers, but they get way more detailed. It can be credit card numbers, they can be cookie identifiers. There's many types of selectors, and if communication is hit by a selector, then it's stored away somewhere for further processing. Now, how many selectors do we have? The BND has 14 million selectors that come directly from the NSA. The NSA is giving the BND 14 million selectors that the BND is running in its systems and trawling the communication lines it taps for. And of these, 40,000 were found to be against so-called German or EU interests. After the BND looked into what the hell are these things that the NSA is giving us, who are the targets of the communication that the NSA wants us to surveil for them?
And they started to investigate, like, what is against those German and EU interests after Snowden. So, and under strange circumstances, because they like started investigating this in different outposts, kind of independently, and they didn't know about each other, allegedly. And that's weird, because they knew about like critical selectors way before.
Yeah, so already in 2005, the BND found out that it had selectors about European companies EADS and Eurocopter, and that the NSA wanted the BND to spy on those companies. Now, they're not the most likable companies exporting arms and military gear to the entire world, but they are partly German companies and European companies, so the BND is legally not really able to spy on them. But they did, for the NSA.
But the committee members are not allowed to see those selectors. Like, they should investigate what the BND was doing wrong and what could make better, but they are not allowed to really look into what they used to spy for the NSA against German and EU interests. So there was a special commissioner. There was a special commissioner who was called like a person of trust. But he was not a person of trust for the committee, he was a person of trust elected by the chancellery, like those who are kind of responsible for all the wrongdoings of the BND. And he wrote kind of a report where he said like, yeah, they had this and this, and there was only like a public version which said nothing concrete, no concrete selectors we got to know. And he adapted like the BND theories in wide parts of his report.
So only because of the inquiry committee, the BND itself found out that it has 40,000 selectors of the NSA against German and European interests. So the committee said, okay, now that you discovered this because of us, we want to see them, right? But the chancellery office said, nope, the inquiry committee, but also other control committees, pretty much no one except the chancellery, the BND itself, and the special person were allowed to see them. So the opposition in parliament and the so-called G10 commission were suing the federal government to be allowed to have a look at those 40,000 selectors that are known to be against German and European interests. But unfortunately, both of those court cases were struck down. One on,
formal reasons?
One on formal reasons and one because they didn't really have standing, unfortunately. So no one is going to be able to see them until someone leaks something.
But there is not only NSA selectors that the BND is using. The BND is also using selectors on its own interests, and sometimes they even take like the NSA selectors, see that they are kind of interesting, and just put them into their own list of selectors. It's 3,300, and yeah, you could suspect that if the BND uses selectors, they are in the German interest. But even those the BND is using himself are against German and EU interests, and it's these 3,300 that are against those interests. There are many more, but we can only see those who have been deactivated after those like investigations, what's wrong.
So what does it mean? This is also theoretical, but we do have a few examples of those selectors. The BND is actively spying on the French ministers of foreign affairs.
And the BND is spying on EU institutions, the commissions of member states, and, for example, like we said before, our commissioner Günther Oettinger.
The BND is spying on NATO and fellow NATO members.
And on the International Monetary Fund.
The BND is spying on the International Criminal Court, aka The Hague.
And it's spying on the World Health Organization.
It's spying on OPEC, the Organization of Petroleum Exporting Countries.
It's spying on the United Nations Children's Fund.
UNICEF, for Christ's sakes. BND is spying on the United Nations Office on Drugs and Crime, UNODC. And those are just the selectors. For someone that you want to surveil, and then in your system on your hard drives ends up all their communication, then there's also this concept called bycatch, that if someone communicates with someone you're surveying, that communication is also stored. And we have some funny examples of bycatch too. The BND was spying on John Kerry.
And on Hillary Clinton, as she was like the Minister of Foreign Affairs.
And the BND was spying on a German journalist that was communicating with an Afghan minister. And that's especially illegal, since the German spy agency is supposed to not be allowed to spy on Germans unless it has explicit reason and legal justification for it.
Yeah, and the BND always says like they filter out all the German communications. They have a filter system that they called DAFIS, which is short for data filter system. But this filter system has some problems because it does not work well enough, because it's kind of, yeah, in the first stage it's a bit primitive. It sorts out all the phone numbers which begin with +49. So if you're a German and you have another phone, because you're maybe living in a foreign country, then bad for you. They also sort out like domains like .de. So if you have like a googlemail.com address, that's a pity. And they try out to filter German IPs, which is kind of strange because it's really difficult to say like from an IP if it's really in Germany, especially if you use like tools that kind of try to hide your IP address. And they say they filter out stuff when they detect, oh, it's spoken in German, we got something, we got like this bycatch is in German, so we throw it away. But that's only possible like if they already got a hit on you. So that's already kind of illegal, and then they say they throw it away.
So they always say this filter works. Then I went to a member of the governing coalition and I said, look, we have a .org domain, I communicate in English, and I use a VPN and Tor. So I'm not in the I'm not filtered out, right? But I'm a German, I have German rights. And I said, well, you're shit out of luck. But for cases like this, with netzpolitik.org, there's another level of a blacklist, but unfortunately we only found out about 20 or so domains that were on them, and one of them was the firefighters Ingolstadt, which we didn't really understand why, but maybe it's time to reread the Illuminatus trilogy. That filter is not really an invention of the BND. They always say, oh, it works, the filter works, we're filtering all Germans, and we even have a certification. We gave it to the Federal Office of Information Security, the BSI, and they certified it as it works. But when asked by the inquiry committee, the guy who actually did that that certification said, well, yeah, they gave me a machine, but I didn't really know what to do with it, so I just read some freaking manual and decided that it sounds okay what they did in there. In the end, it was revealed that the witness itself said, well, what the machine does, only really the BND and God know what it really does. That counts as certification.
Then we ask ourselves, like, how good or how bad are the filters working? Like, what are the numbers we are looking for? What are the percentages of people being filtered out if they are Germans? And there were numbers like 95%, there were numbers like 99%, and that sounds like quite a lot. That sounds like quite good. But if you look at the numbers, then you have like terabytes and terabytes and terabytes of data, and you have millions of connections, and if you take those millions and terabytes, and then you have the 99%, then it's a mass of fundamental rights violation per day. And then the question is, what happens with all this data and metadata that the BND collects and gives to the NSA? There's really serious consequences. For example, there are drone strikes. And we can't go too much into detail, but you can watch the talk that was given yesterday, the Global Assassination Grid, and then you can see what the Americans can do with the metadata they got from Germany partly. Connected to drones, there was also like the base Rammstein, and we had like a witness in the inquiries, which was Brandon Bryant, a former drone operator, and he said Rammstein is absolutely essential to the US drone program. All the information and data goes through Rammstein for the whole world, so they couldn't do their drone operations without their station in Germany.
So this is NSA General Alexander Hayden, and you know probably his famous quote of, we kill people based on metadata. Maybe please the metadata that the BND gives the NSA. There's this thing called signature strikes, where the US institutions don't even necessarily know the names of people that they're killing with a drone strike. They're just analyzing metadata of people that look like a Taliban member, a communicator. NSA General Counsel Stuart Baker said, metadata absolutely tells you anything about somebody's life. If you have enough metadata, you don't really need content. Well, turns out that sometimes you don't really need a trial in the eyes of the NSA in the US before you get shot dead.
There's another thing, like there's not only the metadata, but the BND also uses humans as an information source and give those information to the US where they can like facilitate this for their drone wars. For example, they used refugees as an information source, and it was this Habibi, which is called like the Central Institution for Inquiries. And this was a cooperation not with the NSA, it was a cooperation with the Defense Intelligence Agency, so the military spy agency of the US, and there they got the information from the BND, but not only this, they had those people from the DAA directly sitting in the inquiries of the refugees, and at the end, as they didn't have enough personnel in the BND anymore, they also inquired the refugees alone. So no control over what's happening with this data. And they asked, for example, like phone numbers and places.
Another investigation that was done into the BND was not by the Bundestag and the Inquiry Committee, but by the Federal Commissioner for Data Protection. She went to Bad Aibling, she only visited a single outpost of the BND, and she commissioned a report, a 60-page report, which was pretty damning, but it was classified highly secret, so no one was allowed to read it, until we published it in full on netzpolitik.org. And in there, and in that report, she found out 18 serious violations of laws and the constitutions that the BND was doing only in Bad Aibling. These legal violations were, and these are quotes from her, of outstanding significance, and they are in core areas of the BND's actions. It doesn't get any more damning than that, especially since she's a member of the Conservative Party.
And from that, she issued 12 complaints. Like a complaint, yeah, doesn't sound like much, but it's the strongest weapon of the Data Protection Officer of Germany. And she said, like, the BND severely restricted her right to oversight repeatedly and unlawfully. She said, like, that there are 7 databases, but Aibling alone, without an establishing order, so that the BND would be allowed to run it, and that the stored data of this must be deleted immediately and must not be reused.
So the BND needs to immediately delete 7 databases, including X-Keyscore, is what the commissioner said. Now, is that actually happening? No. Because then there's other politicians, like this friend, Szympanski of also the Inquiry Committee, who said, oh yeah, that report from the commissioner, that was secret. But also, it's her individual opinion, and we have a different opinion, and the government will just keep on doing what it did.
So there's all those things we found out, and what does result from this? Like, that's a question we have to ask ourselves, and yeah, one thing we see that, like, every scandal around a spying agency resulted in more powers for this agency. And what are the other consequences? Like, there was a transparency initiative. There was a transparency initiative because, like, all the cover names of the outposts of the BND were standing on Wikipedia, and so the BND said, like, yeah, okay, then we can put a metal plate on those buildings which are already standing in the internet.
Another not really that damning result was the exchange of BND's president. It's the old president, Gerd Schindler, which was replaced by the new one, Bruno Kahr.
But there are more serious results, or like more staying results, like the BND law. So they implemented a new law, which has many faults. Like, for example, the foreign spy agency inside of Germany is now really officially allowed to be tapping stuff inside of Germany. And they are not only allowed, like before, to request communication lines to be tapped, they are now allowed to just request whole networks.
So instead of one fiber optic cable, and technically they were legally only allowed to tap 20% of that, they can now tap 100% of an entire network, which means BND can legally now finally obtain the full take that it wanted from the DATESIX internet exchange in Frankfurt many, many years ago. So when I asked politicians about that, doesn't that seem like a pretty drastic expansion of the BND's powers, and basically they can do whatever they want? They said, oh, don't worry. They don't have enough hardware and money to do what they're legally allowed now.
But what are the like official targets of the BND? What is he like supposed to do? We always have this argument of like he's fighting against terror, or he's investigating terror, or war, or proliferation. But there's
Germans.
Yeah, if he's trying to spy on Germans, but there's other things. There's like, for example, counterfeiting money, money laundering, and drugs. And there's
the BND can survey Germans if he suspects them of illegal migration help into the EU, like our friends from Sea-Watch who are saving lives in the Mediterranean. The BND, this was from a law change 1.5 years ago that we're suing now against, is not only looking for terrorists, but for malware. The BND is scanning the DATESIX internet exchange for DDoS.
And new with the BND law, so it's now officially possible that he targets the world to retain Germans' ability to act or to gain insights of importance to foreign and security policy, which means, like, if you translate it into one single word, he's allowed to do anything.
So it's not just about terrorism. It's about political power. It's about Merkel sitting at the G20 meeting wanting to know what the Chinese and all her other partners are thinking and how they're prepared for a meeting. That's what Secret Services, what the spy agencies are really for. But those limits that we said now were only for so-called for the contents of your communication. For metadata, there's now officially no limit at all. The BND can take full dump of metadata like it has been doing, and it's legally allowed to give it to partners like the NSA.
We don't only have a new BND law, we also have kind of a new oversight law, which is kind of insufficient. Like, one argument for this is they established a new independent committee, but this independent committee is appointed by the government. So like those who we learned about, that they are not really controlling the BND well, and they don't have any, yeah, not much interest in controlling the BND very well. So they are like the ones to appoint their committee to control the BND better.
The oversight committees had other problems, like a push-pull problem. When the directors of the spy agency sit there, members of parliament can ask any question, but they don't really know what to ask about, what the current scandal is, what the hidden things are. So it's not like the spy agency go there and tell everything that's going on. We had ex-heads of the BND who said, well, I always had a list of things I could have talked about, but they didn't ask the right questions, that somehow the time was up.
Yeah, but it's not just about us saying like that those reforms are kind of wrong, but it's also what experts said in the parliament hearing and many, many more people. So we have like a short 1 minute clip, like a best of what the experts said in the parliamentarian hearing.
Ich halte diese Grundthese, auf der der ganze Entwurf beruht, für falsch und deswegen auch den Entwurf in seiner Gesamtheit für verfassungswidrig.
Am selben Zugriff werden G10-Daten und Ausland-Ausland-Daten erfasst. Dieselbe Technik, es ist ein Gerät, erfasst diese Daten. Dieselben Mitarbeiter arbeiten daran und es ist dieselbe Abteilung.
Ich würde die Reform an Ihrer Stelle so nicht verabschieden, weil die Kontrolle des BND darin zu schwach ausfällt. Die Gefahr besteht, dass der BND weiterhin ein Eigenleben führt und Fehler mit erheblichen diplomatischen und strategischen Flurschaden passieren können.
Die materiellen und verfahrensrechtlichen Schutzstandards sind im Vergleich zu G10 erheblich abgesenkt. Fünftens, die Regelung ist systematisch unglücklich. Die Regelung ist handwerklich nicht wirklich gut. Das ist in meinen Augen verfassungsprozessualer Suizid.
Both those laws were passed and they're entering into force next week with the change of the year. But other consequences for the BND are it's getting more money and more resources. We revealed just last year, after Snowden, after the inquiry committee, that the BND is getting 300 million euros more for this new project called Strategic Initiative Technology, where it's getting new fiber optic cable taps, new SIGINT capabilities, new tools for mass data analysis, and new tools for hacking.
There's other funny operations the BND is getting money for, like 150 million for grabbing cryptography under the name of Aniski and messengers, because they noticed, like, oh, we can only, like, break 10 out of 70 messengers, and we want to break everything and everywhere post Snowden. And they don't use just, like, yeah, technology. They also use human intelligence operations to get access to keys and certificates. And once again, like, every spying scandal, like we saw, results in more powers for the agency, at least until now.
That's pretty unsatisfying. Now, what do we do with that? So, we need to get active. I learned in school and university that democracy is the informed consent of the governed. Well, if I'm not informed, I can't really consent to what is happening. The Snowden revelations and the inquiry committee have shown that the spy agencies are in direct opposition to the principle of democracy. They're operating in secret, and they're not controllable. They're breaking laws, and breaking laws left and right, and with any other institutions, it would have been found illegal and closed down and eliminated already. Why is this not happening with spy agencies? But, and since that is unfortunately not happening, we need to get active in different ways. One example is to litigate, to sue people. I want to sue more people. We have some examples of that too.
There is the opposition suing, like, at the Federal Court of Justice because they want to hear Snowden.
The Frankfurt Internet Exchange, DATSIX, is suing the government for its orders that the Internet Exchange has to hand over data to the BND. Now, I only learned yesterday that once the new law is enforced and they're getting a new order to hand over data, that they're suing on the basis of this new law, which is really, really good and important. Our friends from Reporters Without Borders, together with lawyer friends, are suing the government for surveying journalists and other people of importance for violating fundamental rights, still outstanding.
Amnesty and the Society for Civil Liberties are suing the government for the Article 10 law, and the Society for Civil Liberties is also suing the government for the new BND law. But there is other things to do, like, besides litigation.
So we're trying to do our little part and inform the public. That's called journalism. Now, not everyone was happy with our work so far. We got into a little trouble with the authorities here, but we'll keep continuing your work because you have to find out what's being done in your names with your taxes.
And it's also about, like, being creative, like, looking what can I do best and how can I use this, like, capabilities to do something against those spy agencies. And it's also about, like, drag the spy agencies to light, like, show what they are doing. It's, like, about to understand and interpret. And I think, like, in this room and in this building are many, many people with technical skills that are, like, the ideal people to understand what they are doing in a technical way and to look into that. And then it's about just informing friends, family, and politicians. Like, for example, if you hear something and, like, people don't know about it, just tell them and, yeah, make clear to them what's really happening with their money, with their taxes.
Now, we're at a hacker conference. Obviously, we use technology for self-defense. Now, we need to build those tools. We need to use those tools. That is really important. But it doesn't stop there. We need also need to change the legal basis and society so we don't have to defend our fundamental rights with technology tools. And we've been doing that for a few years now. I mean, that's the CCC's entire point of existence, but somehow we don't always get where we thought the world should be. There's also a concept of direct action, which I've heard that after certain recent election results are probably only going to increase. Now, we've seen people hack the NSA. The BND is running servers on German territory that speak IP, We can't really advocate for illegal things here, but we really would like to see more documents. Send them to us. Letzte Slide. So much for us. Thank you very much. Now we have a QR code with our open PGP fingerprints, and we'll hand over to questions.
Hey. Please stay seated, and I will tell, dear Vok, sorry, we're taking 5 minutes over the time. So come up here.
Shit.
Right here in the middle.
Like the cross?
Instead of now asking questions from the audience, because we have too less time, who would you like to ask a question?
Yeah, we have like this one problem. We have this witness who didn't come to the committee. And we would like to be able to ask him questions, because we have to ask him questions, because he's the number one witness who started all this. And so we have to ask, like, what do you think about what happened in Germany after, like, all those, like, committee things were coming out and, like...
Yeah.
Come on up! Stand up! Give him standing ovations!
Thank you. Thank you very much, guys. Thank you so much. But I got to say, this is CCC. You know, we're always killed for time. So let's talk about this quickly. And again, thank you so much. That's probably the warmest welcome I've ever gotten. The main question that people ask is, first of all, why was I not invited to Germany to speak about this? And I think that's because the truth is sometimes inconvenient. And when we look at what you've talked about, what we're seeing as a response to this, a lot of things become clear that actually are never spoken, that are never sort of stated clearly out loud, that you read in the newspaper, you see in the magazines. Instead, actions are speaking more loudly, more clearly than anyone's words really are. And that's what we've seen, a story that's been told since 2013 in country after country, right? This isn't about nationalism. Forget your flag and think about what's happening to everybody everywhere, even in the United States, even in Germany, even in the United Kingdom, although I'm being generous here. We're talking about very liberal, what we would like to think of, open societies. We see evidence again and again that this kind of mass surveillance, right, indiscriminate surveillance that's just collecting everything off the wires, that's hitting sites like D6, internet exchanges, telecommunications providers all over the world, is they're actually not effective in stopping terrorism. And yet, despite that, we see more and more political support, not only to continue these programs, to expand them, as you say, to fund them to even greater levels. Well, why is that? And I think the answer there is clear. Put yourself in the position of these politicians. Why would they be afraid of upsetting the United Kingdom, of the United States, these sort of international relations where everybody is trading baseball cards, trading sort of dossiers about all of their citizens' private activities? Or maybe they're saying, well, we won't share Germans' information with you, but we'll share the information of everybody else whose lives connects to Germany or transits through Germany. And this is the fundamental basis behind not just mass surveillance, but targeted surveillance. It was never about terrorism, because it's not effective in stopping terrorism. It's not about security at all. It's not about safety at all. It's about power. Surveillance is about control. It's about being able to see moments of vulnerability in any life, whether that person's a criminal, whether they're an ordinary person. And we want governments to be able to investigate serious crimes, or at least some of us do. This is CCC, so I can't speak for everybody in the audience. But, you know, if there's a bad guy out there, we can get a court order with this guy's name on it and say, let's go after them. Let's tap their line. Let's go after their modem. Let's go with the alligator clips outside their house. Let's go in their house when they're not there. We've got a warrant from a court. Let's look at this person's life. Very few people object to that. But this, where we're watching everyone, everywhere, all the time, is an extremely dangerous thing. And I want to point out here that Germany is standing on the stage of history in a real way, because they are the only country that has a real inquiry going on. And unfortunately, we see they're operating from a position of either fear, where they're afraid that they'll lose popularity in this sort of international intelligence ring, or favor, where they're afraid to upset a friend, right? Which is understandable. Nobody wants to piss off their friends. But at the same time, there are greater consequences at risk here. China just passed an extremely harsh new surveillance in December of 2015. When they were asked why they did this, how they could get away with this, how they could justify this, where it compelled technology companies to help them decrypt communications that were going through their servers. And they said, well, this is what every other Western country is doing. Why shouldn't we do the same? Russia just passed their Yarovaya package, which is even worse. It's one of the most blisteringly terrible surveillance laws on the planet. Russians call it the Big Brother law. This is something that should never be passed anywhere in any country. And yet the same kind of thing happens. They go, well, we're just keeping up. They're not. They were probably doing this anyway. But the fact is, we are now ceding the moral high ground. We're now saying it's okay. We're now saying we're not worried about individual rights. We're not worried about human rights. We're only barely concerned with the rights of people within our borders, within our countries, with our passports, right? But human life is not this sort of team sport where we go, what color jersey are people wearing? Human rights are universal. Even in the United States, people go, oh, well, you know, this person's not protected by the Fourth Amendment or something like that. I've got news for you. We signed the Universal Declaration of Human Rights. We signed the International Covenant on Civil and Political Rights. These are international agreements, treaty agreements in the United States. And if you read our Constitution, we have something called a supremacy clause, which means our treaty obligations are equivalent to constitutional obligations. So yes, in fact, foreign citizens, people around the world, also have constitutional protections. You don't have to look to the Fourth Amendment. We have a mesh of other frameworks. And my final thing here, just because I know I've gone long, is that this isn't just happening in China and Russia, right? We were always suspicious of them. We always knew things were going to happen there. They were all just going to play games on the internet. But it's happening in Germany. It's happening in the UK. It's happening in the US. It's also happening in places like Canada. Not old news, not 2013, happening now. This is from the very end of October of this year, right? And it continued through the very beginning of November, where a journalist, and in fact, many other journalists in Montreal were found to be being monitored. Specifically, their phones were being tracked via their GPS, via their tower positions. They were being tracked not because they were suspected of any criminal activity, but because the police department was embarrassed by the stories that were put out that were sourced to people within the police department. So they said, well, if we track the journalists, we can find their sources. And then suddenly their intelligence agency said, ooh, people are responding really badly about this. Maybe we should say that we kind of do the same thing. And the Canadian Intelligence Service said, hey, we are going to do a report about this to tell you when it happened and why and how and justify it. But the unfortunate news here is just a few days ago in this month, in December, they said, we're actually going to take that back. We can't tell you that because this is a state secret. And if we get into that paradigm of confirming what's happening, who's being spied on, when and how, we won't be able to keep secrets anymore. Well, the problem with this, ladies and gentlemen, is secret government is necessarily bad government. You can't substitute the judgment of a few officials behind closed doors for the judgment of everyone in a country, everyone in a nation, not in a democracy. And we can try that. We can even try to work around the boundaries of that. We can create inquiry commissions like we have in Germany right now. But the problem is we will see fundamentally again and again that that paralysis that's injected into our democratic processes by those natural human inclinations, those sort of buffeting winds that we feel on either side of us, of fear or favor that the commission is suffering under right now, where they go, look, what's going to happen if we say we broke the law? Well, we might lose power. We might lose reach. We might lose prestige. We might become less powerful. We might lose our careers. We might lose our popularity. And ultimately, in democracy, whether we like it or not, particularly in recent days, it seems that a lot of our governments are devolving into simple popularity contests. I think in no point is this more clear than in the United States, where we just had the most public unpopularity contest in our history. But it's not enough to talk about the problems. It's not enough to talk about the failings. It's not enough to talk about where the inquiry committee is going, look, we can't talk to these people because the United States might be pissed off. If we do that, what we're saying is that our principles don't matter. Our rights don't matter. The structure of our governments don't matter. Our beliefs, our values don't matter. And if that's the case, why are we playing at this game at all? And if that's the case, all of the restrictions that are put on us in this social contract between the governing and the governed, where we play nice, in exchange for this vote that increasingly means less and less, means we need to start thinking about what we can do directly. Again, everybody in this room is here for a reason. Everybody has things they believe in. Everybody has things that they want to learn. And we've learned a lot in the last few years. But perhaps the most important thing, and what I think we need to all be considering with, is what can we do? We're hackers. We see a problem. Mass surveillance is out there, right? We can't get to targeted surveillance yet. We got a really smart guy who's going to be on stage next, I think Chris Segoyan, talking about the targeted hacking. But mass surveillance was what I set out to let people know about and how we can contest it. But the thing is, all I could do is tell you what's going on. If we're going to make the internet safer, if we're going to make our societies more free, more open, if the generations that come after us are going to enjoy the same rights that we ourselves inherited, that people died for, you're going to have to do something about it. Maybe that's writing code. Maybe that's creating a tool. Maybe that's starting a new service. Or maybe that's recognizing that sometimes you have to say no or vote a different way. But you have to take some action. It's not enough to believe in something, ladies and gentlemen. If we want things to get better, you're going to have to stand for something. Thank you.
Ja, 20 Uhr, Mietnetzpolitik oben in der Bar. Kannst du dem sagen?
That's so awesome how you work. So, Anna wanted to say something to you at the end.
Yeah, one last thing, because we didn't have time for questions now, which is a pity. And we want to give you the opportunity to ask us questions and to get in touch and to, like, yeah, exchange opportunities. And though you can get, like, to the, I think it's called Section 9 up there at 8 p.m. and we will be there and happy to share a beer and
answer
questions.
It's the bar on the top floor all the way over there.
Thank you very much and give them a warm applause. Anna, André Meister and Snowden.